Texoma's only live one-hour high school football show, Gridiron 7, with your hosts, David Bradley and Mike Wolf.
All right, good evening, fans, football fans from all over the place. David Bradley along with Mike Wolf for another edition of Gridiron 7, and lots to talk about. The area schools had a little bit of trouble this week.
As far as the Lawton area schools are concerned, Lawton High playing one of the tougher teams in the state. In Class 6A in Midwest City, the MacArthur Highlanders taking on the number one team in the state in 5A in Duncan. As far as Eisenhower was concerned, they knew they were going to have a little easier go of it, taking on a Mustang team that hadn't won a game yet. But as you look all across the board, it is now time for everybody to get going, because Right. Some of the schools in Texas that had not been in district play yet, they will start district play upcoming for week five. So everybody who had thought that they could get their acts together by the time district rolled around, got to do it come Friday night, because now is when the games matter as far as those playoff berths.
That's right. MacArthur and Duncan, we'll talk a little bit more about them later on there with the game of the week. Duncan looks good. They've been rolling over everybody, including MacArthur. And of course, Eisenhower and Mustang played earlier, and it took them a while to get going the other night, but they finally bucked the Broncos at Cameron Stadium. Take a look.
Out at Cameron Stadium, it's the Eagles taking on the Oxymoron, the Mustang Broncos. Anyway, Coach Chris Stiles said his Eagles would need to run the option well to win. Here's a sample. It's the human highlight reel. Spencer Braggs. He gets the pitch. He wheels his way inside Bronco territory. Then it's another Cajun man play. I'll spare you the cheap impressions this time, though. Braggs gets the pitch from option man Damon Harrison. You know what happens next, folks. Braggs is gone. The Eagles lead it 6-0. When Ike gets the ball back, it's option man again with the pitch to Braggs, who scoots around the right side. This time he's not gone, though. Braggs leaves the gone part of things to his quarterback. The next play, Harris is running man. He goes the rest of the way, 35 yards for the Eagles' second score of the night. The two-pointer's good. It's Ike by 14. But the Broncos came to play. It's not Elway, but Spencer Brazil looks like him. He hits Jason Blackwell over the middle. Those two would ruffle the Eagles' feathers all night.
Mustang's a good team. They're fundamentally, they're tough. They get after you. And we knew that. We knew that coming in.
The bottom line is our kids, we won the football game, and that's really all that's our concern right now.
A couple later, some more feather ruffling. Brazil hits Blackwell, who just gets his feet in bounds. The next play, guess who? It's Brazil to Blackwell on the big scoring strike. The Broncos missed the extra one. 14-6 Ike. This play proves the crack staff at Gridiron 7 knows their stuff. We had Chris Hall on last week's show because we knew he'd do this. Great stick, Chris. Ike tries to get on the board before half. When Coach Stiles sees this on tape, he's not going to be very happy. Damon Harris throws into triple coverage on the goal line. It's picked by the Broncos. But how about the stick of the night? Donnie Caldwell. Dong! Lays a vicious hit on Kyle Jackson. Same guy, different play. Caldwell picks off a Brazil pass. He takes off and ends up inside Mustang land. That sets up this. Brad Farrell gets behind the Broncos secondary, snags the pass from Harris, 19 yards for the score. That seals the deal. That slams the door. That puts the final nail in the coffin. Choose your cliche. The Eagles flatten the Broncos 28-12.
They're an outstanding quarterback. They can throw the football. They've got some good skill people, and they're big and physical up front. So my hat's off to Mustang. They played a fine football game.
We came out and accomplished some things, but times we just let up and times we didn't. And I mean, we've got a lot of things to work on at practice.
I'm Brad Fanning, reporting for Gridiron 7.
Now, Lawton High came up on the short end of a 14-6 loss to Midwest City, a tough game, and time of possession seemed to be a big key for you guys. We got Mark Cooper and Jeremy Burdeau with us. And guys, first of all, talk about the time of possession when you guys don't have the ball. Obviously, you can't put any points on the board.
No. Pretty much put our defense, you know, they were had to play a real good game, and they're on the field a lot of the time, and didn't get our offense on there much.
Jermaine, talk about what you guys thought from Midwest City coming in. You knew they were going to be a pretty good team, pretty good balance. What did they show you? I mean, whatever they did didn't impress you too much, because you only gave up 14 points against a pretty good team. What did they bring in?
Well, they brought in a lot of strong side. I mean, they were strong on the right side. And the quarterback was real strong. I wasn't expecting him to be as fast as he was, and that was hurting us, the quarterback, and the dive plays. But other than that, they wasn't as good as I thought they would be.
I mean, granted, you wish you would have won the ball game, yeah. But whenever you come out of it and then you get a chance maybe to kind of evaluate how you guys play, how did you think that the defense played in the game? Did you like the way they played, or what did you see coming out of it? Think, well, we probably still need to work on this phase of the game a little. Nothing particular really jumped out at you. How's things been going so far, Mark, as far as the offense is concerned this year? You guys, I think when Coach Oschlager at the beginning of the year started talking about offense, he said, well, part of my problem is I got to start a bunch of little guys on the offensive line, and here's one of them right here. Talk a little bit about how that has developed throughout the course of the year, and what do you do to offset the fact that you go about, what, 170, and you're going to go up against somebody that's maybe 240?
Well, offensively, we feel we've come a long way since the beginning of the year, but as far as size goes, just gotta stay after him and be pesty, make him mad.
Mark, what did Coach tell you guys after the game? Because the best field possession you guys had all night was starting from your own 39, so that makes it tough from the get-go.
Yeah, penalties hurt us a lot on that note. Didn't really get a lot of yards without having a penalty bring us back. So that basically was the key factor in that.
Jermaine, talk a little bit about the rest of the teams as far as this district is concerned. I don't know how much you know about all the guys on there, but you know one thing, that Midwest City is usually one of the tougher teams in the district. You played straight up on those guys, so you've got to feel pretty good about your chances of finishing high and having a good playoff spot. Is that something that's came away from?
Mm-hmm.
How do you think you guys are going to rate us against some of those other teams you're going to be playing?
We're real high. I think that we can just take over and keep our, go undefeated from the rest of the way.
Right. So. Jermaine, you guys haven't had a chance to look at any film, I know, on UConn, but kind of talk about some of the things that you guys know you have to work on this week individually and as a team to get better for that team.
Our coach said that they only have four or five running plays and the rest are pass. So I guess we're going to stay in a pass defense.
Mark, talk a little bit about the play of Braden Cagle, quarterback. It seems like he kind of gets on a little bit of a roller coaster sometimes. He gets a little pass here going early on. He's in pretty good shape the rest of the game. So what kind of a big deal is it to make sure that he gets off to a good start? I know you guys up front giving him time to throw make all the difference in the world there.
Mm-hmm. We just try to give him the best protection we can and give him as much time as he needs.
The fact that you guys are small, do you see a lot of blitzes? Or does it make any difference? Can you tell?
No difference. Just whatever they're going to run.
All right. It's Lawton High against UConn next week. UConn lost in overtime to Moore last week as the brothers Little went against each other. So they'll be looking to get going again, and the Wolverines will be trying to get back on the winning track after losing Midwest City. Jermaine and Mark, thanks for joining us, all right? We will take a short break. When we come back, it is time to check in live at Memorial Stadium. We'll also update what happened down south as the Holiday Eagles put quite a scare into the number one team in the state in 2A, Boyd. Stay tuned.
We're taking pride in all we do. Pride in the way that we care for you.
Whoa.
Southwestern Medical Center.
Hi, folks. Steve Laysteel at the Auto Center in Chickasha. And I want to tell you about the new ways of doing business in 94. Stop in and let us show you the smart ways. The Smart Buy program is a great way to lower your monthly payments. Or Smart Lease, with rates as low as 4% and no repair bills. Remember, Smart Lease or Smart Buy, if you want the best deal, you've got to see Steve Laysteel in Chickasha.
These are Tom's friends. Tom's not with them today. He's not in the locker room or at work. He's not in his apartment. Tom is a cocaine addict. And today is the day he finally chose for his new beginning.
For 24-hour help, call Great Plains Hospital at 800-477-WE-CARE.
Welcome back to the show. Dave and Mike along with you. Now it's time to focus in on what's going on in Texas. As far as some of the other schools in Texas, they do get into district play this week. That's Old High. They'll be taking on Burt Burnett in their first district game. Burt came off a win against West Mesquite on Saturday. They snapped a three-game losing streak, Burt did, so that'll be a pretty good game if they get things going. Ryder went out of the friendly confines of Memorial Stadium for the first time all year, and they finally lost a game. They played Denton, and that was a tough game. Went right down to the wire, lost it 10-0. So Ryder's now got to scratch their way back up toward the top of the district standing.
Well, Coach LeBlue talked maybe they were the Denver Broncos last week, and maybe that's the way they took the game because they come up short. And, of course, their first road game of the season, and they'll have to see what they can do and regroup. Of course, the other three schools that we've got to tell you about, Vernon and Hershey, we knew Hershey would have a tough time in that ball game. Old High, we thought, pretty easily against Amarillo, Caprock, and Boyd and Holiday. What a ball game that turned out to be. We were at all three of those ball games, and here's what happened on Friday night.
The Boyd Yellow Jackets already up 7-0 on the Holiday Eagles. Let's get right to the fun stuff. Third quarter, Boyd's Robbie Cartwright throws a bomb to Darryl Etter. It's 55 yards for the score, and now it's 14-0. When Holiday gets the ball back, they would march 65 yards in 13 plays. Here's David Twilliger with the run and a few of those yards. Three plays later, it's tough to see, but Twilliger gets the ball and gets in from a yard out. The PAT's good, 14-7 Boyd. On the ensuing kick, Boyd's Chris Taylor fields it and runs it back 55 yards to the Holiday 34-yard line. The drive would stall at the 9-yard line, though. Cartwright to attempt a 26-yard field goal, but that Twilliger guy spoils everything. He breaks through and blocks it. What would a highlight be without David Twilliger? He's going to break this one for 41 yards, but since holding is illegal, the Zebras bring it back. Late in the fourth, the Eagles still down by a touchdown. Corey McClendon back to pass. He throws a wobbly one that gets picked off by Brandon Smith, but Smith loses the ball. And who else but the highlight hog, David Twilliger, recovers. Same drive, Holiday facing fourth and two, and fullback Blake Belcher converts. Later in the drive, it's fourth and five from the Boyd 28. McClendon rolls right, then runs left. He picks up eight and the first down. 8 seconds left in the ball game. Fly or die for the Eagles. McClendon looking to the end zone. He floats it up. It deflects off a Boyd defender and lands in the hands of Dwayne Keller. One ref says no. The other says yes. The Gridiron 7 end zone cam clearly shows it's a score. It's 14-13. They go for two to the go-to guy, David Twilliger. The pass is low. The coverage is good. And the Yellow Jackets come away with a big victory, 14-13.
We wasn't playing for no tie.
We're at Memorial Stadium in Wichita Falls. It's the Vernon Lions and the Hershey guys, Tom Chancellor and his Huskies. We pick things up with the Lions up 2-0 thanks to a Detrick Morris safety. Now it's Willie Cherry, who had a great night on the ground. He gets the ball from Chris Enloe and puts a move on Tyrone Cherry, and he goes all the way. 83 yards, the Lions get the PAT, and they own the 9-0 lead. Tom Chancellor says, I wish we could do that. And they would, thanks to this guy, Carl Miles. He grinds up a few of his 137 yards on the night. But it's all V-men in the first half. Second quarter action, Chris Enloe hits the receiver he favors most, Brandon Favors. A big gainer down to the Hershey 29. A few hikes later, Enloe to Favors again. It's 15 yards. It's a score. It's 15-0. The Huskies would make it a good ball game, though, but Vernon prevails 22-18. Now to Amarillo, the Coyotes, and the Caprock Longhorns. First quarter action in what would be a big night for quarterback Demetrius Berry, 251 yards and three touchdowns. Here he connects with Gary Zimmerman, and Old High is down inside the 30-yard line. A few plays later, it's Tracy Foster from the one. Steve Ashley says, ain't letting you in there. But on the next play, Foster finds pay dirt, and the Yotes are on top, 7-0. The main man for the Longhorns was quarterback Chris Mason. He rolls right, dices and slices. He cuts so good he could hold down a job at the deli. But then he drops the melon. Caprock's Chris Hill, though, is there to fall on it. Derek Gardner led the ground attack for the Horns. He finds a hole on the left side, breaks a tackle, and puts the Horns in field goal range.
but they would not capitalize. The Yotes put it out of reach in the third, winning their third in a row, 38-14.
And some of the other teams in the region, Iowa Park picked up another win, second in a row. They blocked a field goal, returned it for a touchdown right before halftime, then started the second half with a kickoff return for a touchdown. Brent Brown got the honors there. They beat Wellington easily. Electra rolled over Knox City. They had five different players scoring touchdowns. Jacksboro's Tigers won at Jackrabbit Stadium over Bowie, 17-3. They are 4-0-1 now, Jacksboro. Their only problem is that tie they had with Archer City, and Archer City rolled on Henrietta. Henrietta, again, having a hard time stopping people. They gave up 57 this week. 600 yards total offense for Archer City. Chance McCandless had three touchdowns.
Graham and Mineral Wells. Graham wins that game. The Steers are now 4-1. Julian Taylor had three touchdowns on the ground for Graham Monday, and only 32-15 in favor of Monday, their third straight win there. Seymour and Patrick, Paducah, Seymour wins that game, and Burke Burnett and West Mesquite. Burke comes out on top in that one.
And it's now time to check in on what's going on down in Wichita Falls at Memorial Stadium. Our own Brad Fanning standing by live with not a lightning bolt in sight. Take it away, Brad.
Thanks, Dave. I'm standing by here with the offensive coordinator for the Rider Raiders, Keith Noble. As you know, if you read the newspapers, that is, Rider lost their first ball game of the year to the Denton Broncos last week. A tough loss for them. And once again, Keith Noble with me, Coach. Your bread and butter seemed to be Kevin Wagner, your offense, and they came in and they shut that down.
Yeah, they did. You know, our district is really tough, and there's three or four teams in the district with Sherman and Denton and the two Louisville schools and, of course, the Rider Raiders that are all fairly evenly matched. And you know, I think we got into some trouble the other night and some breaks didn't go our way, that we'd gotten some good breaks in the Sherman ball game, and we didn't get those breaks the other night, and it hurt us a little bit. We couldn't get anything started, and we came out on the short end. You know, the ball game was 3-0 with 48 seconds left to go, and we had to throw a desperation pass out of the end zone late in the ball game, and they picked it off and ended up scoring and made it 10-0, which made it look a little worse, but it was a really tight ball game.
Let's talk about breaks. In a district like yours where there's a lot of tough football teams, what does a break here and there do to your playoff chances?
Well, if you continue to have the bad breaks, of course, it's going to eliminate you from the playoffs. Like I say, our district has got enough good teams in it to where if you lose two or three games, you're definitely probably going to be sitting at home and some other people are going to be going to the playoffs. You just hope that you can eliminate some of those things by good preparation through the week. And, you know, we've gone back to the drawing board this week, and we're going to try to overcome some of the things that happened to us the other night, and hopefully we will. And I think you'll see an improvement.
Okay, well, you've got four wins against one loss, which is still pretty impressive. Right. I talked to Coach Wayne LeBlue early in the season about your offensive line, pretty inexperienced there. Talk to me about how they're coming along, because everybody knows Ryder is a running offense.
Well, you know, there was no experience on that line when the year started this year, and so they've worked for that experience, and they've got five games under their belt now, and there's progress there every week. The thing about it is when you play the size schools we play week in and week out, once we get into district play, your weaknesses are really going to show up. And I think that we're going to have to go back and do some things that we've been sitting in there a lot of times foot to foot with people and trying to just power over them. And so we're going to have to do some things to spread some people out a little bit. And I think you'll see improvement in our offense.
I guess when you talk about your offense, you can't leave out the big guy, number 22, Kevin Wagner. Tell me about his season thus far.
Well, Kevin's had a really great start to, I think, what's going to end up being a fantastic season for him. He's rushed for over 600 yards in offense and thrown a touchdown pass and had a lot of things go his way. You know, Kevin can't do those things without a lot of support people behind him. But, you know, right now Kevin's our go-to guy. That's the guy we want to go to when we need something to happen in a ball game. And what we've got to do is be able to block for him where he can get into a secondary and make some good things happen.
Okay, once again, Mike and Dave, we've got Coach Keith Noble, the offensive director for, offensive coordinator for the Rider Raiders here with us at Wichita Falls. We want to thank him for coming out and talking with us. So for now, we'll send it back to the studio to the Wild Pair, Mike and Dave.
Okay, Brad, thanks a lot, and good luck to the Raiders this week as they take on Louisville. All right, now as far as the other teams in Texas are concerned, as far as the Wichita Falls schools, Hershey home to take on Boswell Friday night, and then Old High there Saturday to take on Burke Burnett. Now, as far as we shift back to Oklahoma is concerned, usually we're talking about Altus in this time of the show. Altus went to Westmore, lost 10-7. Great game, though, for the Dogs confidence-wise to show that they can play with one of the better teams in the state.
They got on the board first, Jason Thomas and Steve Ogden, 7-0 at that point. They couldn't hold. They lost in the late going, but Jim Holloway had to be happy to see those guys play that good with Westmore.
And maybe the best game in all of the state happened in 3A at the Bomber Bowl between Frederick and Plainview. Figured to be one of the Bombers' toughest games of the season, but it wasn't. They won it. Take a look.
We're at the dreaded Bomber Bowl. Frederick Plain rude host to the Plainview Indians. But here come the Indians early in the first. Daniel Johnson fakes the handoff, but Photog Jimmy Taylor's on it like a hornet. Michael Beard with the great reception. First and goal for the Indians. Two plays later, Nicky Faulkner gets the ball, spreads the D. He's in from 4 yards out. The PAT fails. It's 6-0 Indians. So head coach Ed Jones digs in the Bomber playbook and finds the fake halfback pass. Ryan Benn finds no one, so he takes it himself. He racks up 73 yards of his game-high 217 yards right here. The Bombers lead it 7-6. Then Plainview runs the hook and ladder play. Brandon Seipert is the recipient of the pitch from Brian Cook. He'll go 65 yards for the score. The Indians back on top 12-6. Now we're in the second quarter. It's yet another big play. The give to Ryan Benn. What a great ball game for him. This time he goes 51 yards before being dragged down. He loses the ball, but Fred recovers. George Mitchell would score on the next play. It's 14-12 Fred. After a Thomas Gaten interception, Jay McCullough drops the snap, but he picks it up and throws 5 yards to Greg Hilburn for the score. It's 21-12 Bombers. Defense was a big part of this game. Here McCullough overthrows his fellow Bomber, and it's Michael Beard with the interception. All's quiet on the scoring front until McCullough hits Gaten in the fourth. That play sets up this play. McCullough calls his own number. He gets in from 9 yards out. The Bombers go on to win this thing by the score of 28-12.
Are them Bombers for real?
And we'll see how for real they are this week when they take on Marlow. That should be one of the great games of the season, too. And whoever wins that really has a leg up on winning the district. Now, as far as eight-man football is concerned, year in, year out, the team to look for is Granfield. And we've got a couple of the Bearcats with us here. Zara Morris, closer to me, he plays center for the Bearcats. And one of his big partners is Darius Greer, quarterback. And usually we're talking about victories every week with Granfield, at least until you get maybe late in the season or a playoff loss or something like that. You guys took on a Butner team. Central had played them before, played them close, and the Central guys said that Butner was a lot tougher than they thought. What happened in that game? I understand you had a problem with turnovers all night long, though, Zara.
Turnovers were real bad. We fumbled the ball a lot, and we didn't come out as fired up as we needed to come out to play a team of that caliber.
Darius, was a situation of maybe thinking that you probably could play maybe not even your best game and still beat those guys, or was it just one of those deals when the turnovers started mounting, it kind of just steamrolled on you, and the next thing you knew, you were in the last quarter, and they still had a chance?
Yeah, it was kind of like that. I felt that if we would have had as many turnovers, we probably could have beat those guys.
Darius, back to the turnovers. How frustrating was it for you late in the ballgame? You guys are only down by a couple of points, and you got two INTs late in the ballgame that stopped a couple of drives.
Well, it made me feel pretty bad. Felt like I could have thrown a lot better than I had. Turned it over and they won the game.
Zara, compare this team to last year and maybe even the year before that. I mean, what are the differences from a year ago?
They came out playing a lot harder and they're a lot bigger this year. Their line was just massive and we had to work real hard to block them and get them out of the way, but we did a real good job of it. It just came out too many fumbles.
Darius, you guys two-time defending state champs, probably the team still that's going to make some noise at the end of the year anyway. What differences have there been in the Granfield club from a year ago that you're having to battle or maybe fight through this time around?
Well, from looking at the last 2 years, we lost a lot of size, and now we got a speed to rely on.
Now, Zara, talk a little bit about Thackerville. That's who you guys got coming up this week, another district opponent, and you guys probably haven't had a lot of time to look at the film yet, but you beat them last year. Kind of talk about some of the things you guys can expect from those guys.
Well, we're going to expect them to play a really good game. We're going to go out and we're going to practice real hard this week and get things together that we need to fix from last Friday night and just go out and play a real tough game.
Last question. Let me get a comment from both of you. Central coming up next to the last game of the season. What do you think about it? And you know they're aiming toward that one.
I think we're going to have to go out and play hard and execute a lot of options on them.
we play real hard and come out real fired up, we can do pretty good.
Okay, Grandfield takes on Thackerville this week, but a couple on weeks on down the road. I think it's week 9. It's Central versus Grandfield, and that'll be one of the better games of the year. We're going to take a short break. When we come back, it is the return of the Athlete of the Week to Gridiron 7, so stay tuned.
I think you'll find a large selection of clothing to satisfy any man. Personalized service, we can't stress that enough. Plus, we offer a wide variety of sizes in Mr. Big and Mr. Tall. Our customers trust us. While they're here, we make them feel comfortable. And they're happy when they leave. That's why our customers keep coming back.
Only Bronze. Only Brahms makes a hot fudge sundae with rich and creamy Brahms ice cream. We smother it in thick hot fudge and more hot fudge. Sprinkle with toasted almonds, add whipped cream and a cherry, and you've got a hot fudge sundae the way we make them. Only at your neighborhood Brahms.
The Gridiron 7 Athlete of the Week is brought to you by your Oklahoma Country Ford dealer.
You gotta hit the ground running. When you're talking truck, nobody knows more than the Truck Authority, your local Ford dealer. He has America's best-selling trucks, like the Ford F-150. Safety is no longer an option. The new F-150 comes with a driver's side airbag and anti-lock brake standard. When you're ready to talk truck, talk to the Authority, your local Ford dealer.
You better hit the ground running in a new Ford truck.
It's the return of the Gridiron 7 Athlete of the Week, and our first honoree is Carlos Baker of Frederick. He's 6'5", 250 pounds, and he rarely leaves the field. He gets a break on kickoffs, and that's it. The senior tackle anchors one of the best lines in the state in Class 3A football. Baker is on the wish list of several major colleges, including OU and Texas. He's not tipping his hand on where he'd like to end up, but one thing's certain. If the Frederick Bombers end up with the state championship, Carlos Baker will have played one of the biggest roles on the team. And joining us now, Carlos Baker of Frederick High School, our first winner of the Gridiron 7 Athlete of the Week Award, and Earl Herring of the Frederick Auto Center. And first, let's talk to Carlos a little bit. Carlos, first, just talk a little bit about the game with Plainview the other night and how that went. That was a team that you knew you were going to have to beat if you wanted to win district. Dominated them pretty well from start to finish. How did it feel out on the field?
It felt pretty good. You know, they have two pretty good running backs. You know, the running back, Brandon Slafferty, averaged about 200 yards a game. And we pretty much held him in check all night. I think he ended the game with about 103 yards rushing, but that came, you know, like on like a 48-yard run almost at the end of the game. So we held him in check pretty much all game.
And offensively, things went pretty well for you guys. You scored 28 on a pretty tough defense.
Yes, we did pretty good on the offensive line, you know, coming behind blocks with Jody Briscoe, you know, a guard, you know, and center Brandon Phillips and Daniel Lags, you know, and all those guys, you know, putting in work on them. And, you know, our running backs did pretty good also. Ron Bean rushed for over 200 yards. You know, our other running back, Kevin Isham, you know, he had over 100 yards rushing.
Carlos, they always talk about the line being the place where the games are won and lost, and you're playing both on the offense and defensive line, and that is something that's sometimes a little bit of a cliche, but it's really proven this year that that's probably when you guys have played well in the games you've won, it's because of the dominance on the line. Talk a little bit about that play as a unit. Do you know each other well enough to know what's going to
happen? Yes, we know each other pretty well. You know, we all play together, you know, in junior high, basically all of us, you know, out there just now. And, you know, our defensive line, you know, pretty good. Daniel Lash, you know, had a tackle, and Neil Whitworth and Shea with all the defensive ends and linebackers, Clay Johnson, all of them, they do pretty good. And our secondary, you know, is, you know, they go out and play pretty well.
Next up, you have Marlowe, and that's always a big rival. So what do you look at whenever you play those guys? And really, even though you have a few games left, you beat Marlowe, looks like you're in the driver's seat to win the district if you don't stumble the rest of the way.
Yeah, if we go out, you know, play hard every week, you know, we can go out and win district. Marlowe's there, a pretty good team. And if we just stop the run game, I think, you know, we can just do pretty good against them.
Okay, Carlos is one of the more highly recruited linemen in the state of Oklahoma, and if you're seeing he's got a Texas shirt on there, you might say he's tipping his hand. Is that just a shirt that you like, or is that what
it's just like? It's just a T-shirt I like, that's all.
Okay, so keep you posted here on what Carlos will decide later on in the year. Okay, Earl Herring, let me turn it over to you for the presentation of our first Athlete of the Week Award on Gridiron 7.
Well, Carlos, on behalf of the Oklahoma Country Ford dealers, I'm pleased to present you with this Gridiron 7 Athlete of the Week Award. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Herring. Thank you, Carlos. Good luck to you and the rest of your teammates the rest of the year.
Oh, yes, and I'd also like to thank the Oklahoma Ford Country Dealers for recognizing me for this award, and I'd also like to thank my team because, you know, without my team, none of this would be possible.
All right. We will continue with more of Gridiron 7 right after this.
In Oklahoma, staying on the move means driving a truck you can depend on. A truck from the Truck Authority, your local Ford dealer. Check out the all-new 94 F-150 with a driver's side airbag standard and options like split-bench seating, a keyless entry system, and turbo diesel power. Available now at your local Ford dealer.
You better Instagram running in a new Ford truck.
The Gridiron 7 Athlete of the Week has been brought to you by your Oklahoma Country Ford dealer.
It's your favorite time of the show, time to check out the new Super 7, and we do have a new number one team. Let's take a look at number 7, the VA Comets just rolling right along. We'll see if they can keep that undefeated record going. And then at number 6, we move Holiday down, even though they came within a fingertip of knocking off the number one team in the state, Boyd.
At number 5, Frederick, they've been on a roll after losing to Clinton. They've been winning since then. And Vernon, coming off their loss, they beat Hershey this week. They are in at number 4.
Ryder was the former number 1. Their loss to Denton drops them all the way to number 3. The Eisenhower Eagles look strong against Mustang. They are at number 2.
And at the top spot, Duncan Demons. They've been rolling over everybody. They rolled over Mac this week. We'll talk more about that in the next segment. But they've been looking good and can't find any reason not to put them at number 1.
And with Ardmore having lost, they are separating themselves as far as the rest of the state in Class 5A. Now, some of the other area teams playing, Hobart is a team to contend with in Class 2A. Apache is looking awfully good. Both picked up victories. Here's how.
It's homecoming for the Bearcats, and they're taking on the Elgin Owls. Let's start things off in the third quarter. The Bearcats up 7-0. Hobart QB Tommy Talley. He hits tight end Eddie Bynum over the middle. Down to the Owl, 25-yard line. Two plays later, Talley in the pocket. He hits Eric Gubser for 14 yards in the touchdown. The Bearcats up 14-0 on Elgin. After holding Hobart to 7 points in the first half, things started to fall apart for the Owls. Justin McNeil swarmed by Michael Scallion and company. That set up the Cats in great field position, and this time it's Talley on the option. Keeper right. Shakes one tackler to the sideline, and he is gone. Touchdown, Tommy Talley for Hobart. They led it 21-0. That's enough to make any Owl's head spin. The Bearcats go on to win it by the score of 35-0 and move their record to 4-1, 2-0 in district play.
They hate to lose. And, you know, at halftime, one of our seniors stood up. We said, hey, what's it going to take to wake you guys up? And one of our seniors stood up and said, it's not going to be another loss. So, you know, he stood up and said, hey, we got to come back. And you can see the difference in our defense, especially the second half.
Homecoming at Apache, the Warriors looking to beat up on the Mangum Tigers. The Warriors came out running, literally running the ball right down the Tigers' throat. Here's Daniel Caratini. Good night for him. About 5 of those running plays later, Jonah Pickens gets across the goal line from a yard out. The Warriors lead it 7-0. Good night for the Apache special teams, too. First quarter, Mangum forced a punt, and it's Heath Claiborne deep to receive it for the Warriors. Now the fun starts. Claiborne lets the ball hit. Bouncing around, looks like a little bit of trouble, but then he gets some good blocks. And Heath Claiborne takes off down the sideline. Somebody's going to get him, right? Wrong. Claiborne goes the distance. 85 yards. Touchdown Apache. The Warriors go up 13-0. Second quarter action. Warrior QB Jeremy Lee rolls right, throws deep to his streaking Caratini. The ball's tipped by Andy Beal, but it wouldn't matter. It's a score! The Apache offense still rolling. They set up the screen. Claiborne's got a wall, gets in the open field, breaks one tackle, and goes 52 yards for the touchdown. It's 27-0 Apache. In the second half, the Warriors pick up where they left off. It's Claiborne again, and it's a touchdown again. It's 2 yards and a 33-0 lead. Mangum would mount a good drive late in the third. Jeremy Ward picks up a few of his 113 yards right here. They wouldn't score, though. They would score later in the fourth quarter. After a good drive, it's Jason Carper on the keeper, but it's still a laugher. The Warriors win it 40-8.
And joining us now, a couple of representatives from the Rush Springs Redskins. At last report, ranked number 9 in the state. And we are joined by Joe Jones, closest to me, and Bubba Fitzgerald. And these guys were looking at that Mangum Apache stuff pretty good because that's another district opponent. Talk a little bit about, I know you got to look at a game with Hinton this week, but down the road you're going to play an Apache team that right now is looking like one of the better teams in the district. What do you see when you see that Apache Warrior Club?
Apache's always got a pretty good team, and it's always a pretty good rival. But you're right, we're looking forward to it. We can't slip up on one of these games before.
Bubba, how do you guys feel about yourselves after the loss to VA? It looks like you guys have rebounded pretty well and got things back on track.
Well, right now we're going through a lot of changes. Of course, our main tailback, Monty Bishop, he got hurt. But we had a guy come in, Matt Reek, and he's came in earlier in the season. He's really helped us out in our passing game. And I think once we get Monty back, we'll really have a powerful offense.
What is the status on Monty at this point?
Oh, right. He just kind of banged his knee up a little. They've been putting ice on it and working with it. He came back to practice this week, and I think probably he'll be able to go by Friday.
Joe, this week you guys have Hinton, a team that in past years hasn't really been all that strong. This time they're looking pretty good. What do you know about Hinton, and what are you going to have to do to beat those guys?
Hinton's got a lot of people back this year. They're not a real big team, but they're real fit, quick and fast, and they just the team could cause a lot of problems if you don't get on them.
Let's reflect back to that VA game just for a second. Close ball game, tight fit. Would you wish you would have won that? Woulda, coulda, shoulda all the way through the bank. But do you come out of that, though, with an idea that this is the number one team, and that gives you some idea that, hey, if that's the best there is, you guys are right there with them?
Yeah, right. We would love to beat them, but we're going to make a positive thing out of it. You know, if we can play with them, we can play with anybody in the state.
All right, Bubba, talk a little bit about what you guys have as far as the rest of the season is concerned. At the beginning of the year, I'm sure you said, hey, let's make the playoffs. Let's get a couple of rounds in. Now you've got a pretty good head of steam going here. Does the goal change a little bit to think a little bit even further down the line as far as what you'd like to accomplish with this year's team?
Well, in the past year, Rush Springs is mainly focused on making the playoffs. But after we started playing and we have a passing attack now, we used to be mainly just a running offense. But now that we've got a passing attack, I really think that we can go pretty far in the playoffs. We can play at the best with them. We played VA to 1 point, and I think that we can pretty well hold our own as far as in Class A.
Maybe one of the better teams we've seen in recent memory for the Rush Springs Redskins, and a couple of the big reasons why are a couple of these guys up front, Joe Jones and Bubba Fitzgerald. Guys, thanks for taking the time to talk to us. Good luck to the Redskins rest of the way.
Thanks.
Thank you.
All right, we're going to take another break. When we come back, more Gridiron 7 coming your way, so do not budge from the front of your television.
Now, reports of a legendary two-footed object have been growing.
Anything? Nothing.
It must be big. Even Chet's seen it.
We're getting something.
Coming over the hill, Sarge.
Hit the line, boy!
Bigfoot Pizza, the legendary value from Pizza Hut, with 2 square feet and a tasty new crust you can't get anywhere else. All for $10.99.
Okay, folks, let's break it up.
Bigfoot Pizza, the biggest pizza you can get delivered.
The Kids Good Health Series is brought to you by Southwestern Medical Center and 7 for Kids.
Usually what they're dealing with is fitting in and peer pressure and finding out who they are and what they can do.
I think one of the best ways to deal with peer pressure is to, like, add humor into it and lighten up the tone. So, you know, you won't look stupid or anything, but yet you'll be getting out of the problem.
We all like to foul at one time, but we need to make our own decisions.
I think peer pressure is good because it helps you to become an individual. It makes you decide on things early in life.
It does go back to the family and the parents to just know it doesn't matter what other people think of you.
you know, to just be happy with yourself and enjoy your life. Don't worry about what everyone else is going to think.
Kids, don't miss Youth Rally Lawton. Author Josh McDowell and Wes King will host the rally October 20th at the Great Plains Coliseum. Call 536-8886 for ticket information. The Gridiron 7 Game of the Week is brought to you by Whataburger.
Mission Control, we're initiating the docking sequence now.
Roger. It's looking really terrific on this end. Everything's a go.
Roger, Mission Control. Trajectory's right on track. Down just a couple. Lining up nicely.
Whataburger is proud to announce an historic event. Now we've joined the great taste of lean, thick-sliced bacon with all your favorites at Whataburger.
Mission Control, the docking sequence has been completed.
You just made a lot of folks real happy down here.
All right, it's time for the game of the week. Duncan and MacArthur played earlier this week at MacArthur Stadium. Duncan winning 40-0 at Cameron Stadium, rather 386 yards on the ground. With me is Ray Sonkson from Whataburger, as well as Cameron Etheridge and Braylon Arrington, both of the Duncan Demons. And first off, Cameron, you guys got on the board quickly after that goal line stand and the 90-yard score from Brian Morton. How did that affect you guys the rest of the ballgame?
We just turned up the notch after that. The first kickoff of the game, they turned it all the way down to about our 40. And after they just drove all the way down to the one, they had first and goal about the half-yard line. We stopped them from there. And Coach Lynch always tells us that first play of the game, quarterback sneak's usually a good one. He broke it for 99 yards and just proved his point.
Braylon, you look at the scoreboard, you guys shut him out. And the coach mentioned a lot of good things, but he did mention that you guys were a little soft in the secondary. What do you think he meant by that?
Well, we had a lot of problems with our secondary. They wouldn't converge on the ball. They had a few more passing interceptions. Well, they should have had some interceptions, but they didn't quite converge on the ball like they should have.
Cameron, the big thing, you guys had no turnovers. You guys got to be pleased with that.
Right. Coach Patterson, our defensive coordinator coach, he's been stressing this year that we have more turnovers our way than we had last year going against the other team. And right now, I think our total's up to +7. We had 3 takeaways against MacArthur. We didn't give up the ball in.
Braylon, finally, are you guys where you think you need to be at this point in the season? Obviously looking good in the win column, but are you guys feel comfortable with where you are?
Well, you can never feel comfortable. I mean, we need to keep getting better every week. And so far, we've been doing that. I think we'll be a contender.
All right, now we're going to turn it over to Whataburger representative Ray Sonkson for the trophy presentation. Ray?
I want to present you all with this trophy for being the winner of the game of the week and congratulate you all for playing a great game. Congratulations.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
All right, we're going to show you what happened in that Duncan MacArthur game Friday night at Cameron Stadium. Here it is.
It's that time of the week, folks. Whataburger game of the week time. We've got Mac and Duncan squaring off at Cameron Stadium. Mac looks good early on. Reggie Williams fields the opening kick. He's going to be off to the races, folks, inside Demon territory. Ernie Manning with the gutsy call, 4th and 15. The Highlanders, they go for it. And it pays off. Reggie Williams with a great grab. Mack would get it inside the 5. First, it's Ramon Paul. Stopped. Then it's Lynn Rash on the keeper. Nope. Again, nope. Third time's a charm, right? Well, not for Mack. It's a great defense by the Demons. Big Mack attack looks more like a what a chicken fries after the opening drive. Duncan's first play from scrimmage. Brian Morton on the keeper. Where's the D? Believe it or not, he's going to weave his way 99 yards. For the score, Duncan goes on top, 7-0. After Duncan's Cameron Etheridge recovers a loose pitch and runs it in the end zone to put the Demons up by 13, Mack puts together another drive. It ends with Frank Williams' 30-yard field goal attempt, doink, hitting the right upright, no good. The Demons' next drive, Lester Jackson gets the call. He scampers around the left side before Reggie Williams knocks him OB at the 4-yard line. A couple later, it's Alex Villagrana. He busts in from 4 yards out. It's 20-0, and we're still in the first quarter. But Mack showed flashes of good football. Rich Reagan rips through the Demon line and drops Mike Mitchell for the loss. It would be 27-0 at the break, though.
I thought Mack came out and played a real enthusiastic type first half, and realistically, the score could have been 7-7 at the end of 24 minutes.
Duncan on the move again in the second half. This time it's Wes Chastain with a 15-yarder. He scores. The Demons go up 34-0. Later in the second, Cameron Etheridge dashes any hopes of the Highlanders getting on the board when he intercepts this rash pass. He, along with the Demons, run away with this thing. Duncan wins it 40-0.
We just got a young team, and
a lot of inexperienced kids who this is their first year stepped up on varsity, you know, and everybody's out there doing their best, trying to make it work.
It's always been a great series with Lawton MacArthur, and we're just glad to be able to come over here on the turf and go away with a victory.
As far as records go, the Demons moved to 5-0, 2-0 in district play, and the Mac Highlanders are still 0-4. I'm Brad Fanning, reporting for Gridiron 7.
And this week's Game of the Week will match the Eisenhower Eagles and the Altus Bulldogs. And we're joined by a couple of members of the Altus Club, Steve Ogden closest to me, Ben Osborne next. And then on the far end is Damon Harris, quarterback for the Eisenhower Eagles. First of all, Steve, let's talk about your game that you had last week with Westmore. Tough one, 10-7, came down to, you know, last quarter. You guys have been through that before. Talk about that game and what you were able to learn coming out of it as far as how you felt about your team.
Well, we went into a new offense. We started the wishbone. I think our line showed a lot of improvement that week. We got better blocks, and our backs hit the holes good. I think all in all that our team played really well. I think we deserved the win in that game.
Ben, talk about what you're trying to accomplish offensively. I think Coach Holloway talked about that all year long. He said never really able to get any kind of a rhythm. And what have you been able to kind of get into this week with this wishbone situation?
Well, I think the wishbone has given us a new look, you know, a new direction to go, because we were kind of floundering in our own offense. We couldn't, like you said, we couldn't get a rhythm going. But I think everyone's kind of taking this as, you know, a new start, and with the wishbone doing their best, you know, working hard at it. I think it's helped us out a lot.
And defensively, once again, another strong effort. Westmore started out the year in the top 10. I don't think they were whenever that game began, but you got to feel good about the way your defense is played. Talk about that club as far as the unit and on that side of the football. Every weekend, I was giving you guys a chance to win the game.
Yeah, our defense has been holding the other team to about 2 touchdowns a game, and Westmore didn't even score a touchdown against us. They held them pretty good. The fumble on the punt was big.
Damon, let's bring you into the mix now. You guys played Mustang last week and picked up a pretty good victory there. You coming in, you knew that if you played as well as you could and Mustang played as well as they could, you'd probably win the game. How did you feel about that whenever you came out of it?
Well, basically, I felt pretty good after the game. I felt that I made a couple of mistakes that coaches have been talking to me so far this week about throwing the ball into a crowd of people. But basically, I felt pretty good. You know, Mustang is a pretty good team.
Talk a little bit about your development as a quarterback this year. You and I talked at the beginning of the season about how you knew in the summer that there was going to be an opening. You worked on that. Have you been able to gauge your own progress outside of what the coach has been able to tell you, kind of where you thought you would be at this point in the season? How's it gone for you personally?
Personally, it's going pretty good. Coach Stiles prepared me. Coach Stiles and Coach Whitman prepared me for basically anything that I would see. All it has to do with reps that you get in practice, and I've been getting plenty of reps, and Coach has been working pretty good with me.
After you lost to Del City, everybody was kind of mad, if more than anything else, I think. Has everybody pretty much put that out of their mind right now, and now you're just looking at how you can finish in the rest of the district?
Yes, everybody put that out of their mind. That's a game in the past, you know. Even though, you know, we got a couple of bad calls, we shouldn't have put ourselves in that situation anyway. So we felt that, hey, we just got to put that game behind and keep going on.
Got Altus this week. What do you know about those guys? One thing that a lot of people talk about is that long drive. It seems like that kind of wears on you whenever you get out there. Sometimes it takes a half to wake up. Have you thought anything? What do you remember about the Altus game from last year?
Well, basically last year I was hurt on the sideline, so I didn't get a chance to play that game. But from what the coaches tell us, they have a pretty tough defense, and our offense has been producing basically on every team we play, but we're looking for our first challenge. Our first big challenge.
Ben and Steve, let me get a quick impression from you guys on the Eisenhower team. Been able to probably, I don't know how much game film we've had a chance to look at, but at least you've been able to see some results, and you know, they're going with them beating what time. What do you think about them? What do you remember about last year's game, Steve?
Well, last year they played us really well, and they have really strong offense. They can score just about anybody. But I think our defense has been playing well, and I look forward to the defense holding them and giving our offense a chance.
Ben, what do you think?
Well, they have a very talented squad, you know, a lot of talented players and stuff, and we're just looking to keep ourselves in the game, give us a chance to win, and hopefully we take care of those chances.
Okay, it is Eisenhower against Altus in the game of the week next week at Altus, so join us for that, and one of these clubs will be able to get the trophy for the Whataburger game of the week. We're going to take another break. When we come back, we will introduce you to one of the top quarterbacks in the state of Texas. His name is Chris Enloe. Stay tuned.
The Gridiron 7 Game of the Week has been a presentation of Whataburger.
Mission Control, we're initiating the docking sequence now.
Roger, it's looking really terrific on this end. Everything's a go.
Roger, Mission Control. Trajectory's right on track. Down just a couple. Lining up nicely.
Whataburger is proud to announce an historic event. Now we've joined the great taste of lean, thick-sliced bacon with all your favorites at Whataburger.
Mission Control, the docking sequence has been completed.
You just made a lot of folks real happy down here.
Most of our customers come to AutoZone for low prices and for parts they can replace themselves. But many people come because we speak their language. You know, things like duration and lift and compression ratios, stuff like that. Because a guy who's going to rebuild an engine, he won't buy parts from just anybody. And since AutoZone stocks complete engines, we know what makes them tick inside and out. Sure, we sell our best parts at our best prices every day. But if we know something that's going to help you do the job right, you get that free.
If you've ever thought about new siding or new replacement windows for your home, America's Helping Hand is the company to call on. We always offer the lowest rock-bottom prices every day and the best first-quality siding and windows. So call now and take advantage of our everyday sale prices at America's Helping Hand. Beautify your home, increase the value, and reduce high energy bills. With new siding and windows from America's Helping Hand, call toll-free now for an appointment and free estimate. Don't delay. Call America's Helping Hand today.
He's Dave. I'm Mike. We're back with a final segment of Gridiron 7 for this week's edition, and we're going to talk about a great quarterback down in Vernon. Leo Britton has got his hands full with a great guy down there.
And whenever you listen to Leo Britton talk about his players, most of the time he comes from the school of really low-key and things, and he will go ahead and admit to you, yeah, we like this guy, yeah, we like that guy. But whenever you get a guy like that that's low-key that comes right out and says, boy, he is about as good as they come, not just in the guys that he's seen, not just in his district, not just in his class, but in the whole state, then you know you're getting quite a bit. And that's one of the things that seems like every year at Vernon, whether it's a running back or a lineman, or this year it's a quarterback, there's always a class player that's as solid as you'll see any place. And the folks in Vernon really know what they've got, quite a prize there in Chris Enloe.
That's right. And he's got all the great attributes of a great quarterback: size, speed, and he can throw. And Brad Fanning takes a look at Chris Enloe and what he means to the Vernon Lions.
Real dedicated, hard-working, a lot of talent, too.
The first thing that pops in your head when Chris Enloe comes up?
Quarterback.
He carries the whole team. He just brings it up.
He also brings another threat to the Vernon Lions offense. He's quarterback Chris Enloe.
Chris can not only throw the ball real well, but he's got outstanding speed and quickness. And, you know, he's a threat anytime he drops back to pass to run the ball.
In his senior season, Enloe has posted some pretty impressive numbers. Through the air, he's been good for 457 yards and 3 touchdowns. His ground game has been equally as potent, rushing for 138 yards and a score. But that's just part of what he has to do to make Vernon a winner.
Go! Inside, inside, there you go.
I try to be a leader, and the coaches expect me to be a leader, and you've got to be a leader. I'm a senior now, and I'm a quarterback, and you know, this is my team, and I'm going to do what I can with them.
Chris Enloe's been the starting quarterback for the Vernon Lions for the past 3 years, and it looks like he's going to have the same opportunity at the Division I level.
Well, the University of Texas is a really top team heavy. Arkansas, OU, well, he's got even some material from UCLA, USC, some of those people.
Right now, I'm not really worried about it. I'm worried about the season right here and getting through it first, and after the season's over, I'll look more into it.
When Chris is 100% and he's got a little hurt shoulder right now, I don't think there's a better quarterback in the state of Texas, and I think that most of our athletes know that.
And everyone else knows Chris Enloe will be a great college quarterback. I'm Brad Fanning, reporting for Gridiron 7.
And the Vernon Lions, of course, kind of in a funk now because they actually look at their record and they say we've got a loss on it already. But that came to Pampa, a team that's a 4A squad, bigger than they are. And Pampa's played just about everybody. They've played tough. They've gone up a class or so and played some teams awfully tough. So Vernon's still going to be the team to beat. Also, with the rankings are concerned, in Texas, the Lions had been number 5 in the state. After that loss to Pampa, they bumped back up to number 4. They flopped spots with Gainesville. South Lake Carroll still the number 1 team. They won again 66 in a row, right. I think they've gotten now unanimous for the first time all year in any class to have a unanimous number 1 team, so that's South Lake Carroll. But again, Vernon moving their way back up a little bit. They're still going to go ahead and dominate everybody that they play, it looks like, in their district. They get Iowa Park this week. We'll see if they can steamroll it. And you know, at the end of the season, they're going to be one of the teams to beat for the state title.
Well, they started off the season at number 2 right behind South Lake Carroll, dropped after the loss to Pampa, but they're moving right back up, and I'm sure by the end of the season they'll be right up there at the top.
It's October. Can you believe it?
I can.
Is it just me or not? All of a sudden, you just wake up and you look at the calendar, and I've been writing checks wrong all the time because I'm still I can't believe that it's the 10th month of the year. Incredible.
Did you write me my check yet?
I did not, and I will not. Let's take a look at what we've got as far as ye old pick'em segment. Last week, Dave pulled another perfecto at 5-0. Wolf slept a little bit, goes to a 3-2 now last week. So for the season, it's just like the Braves and the Giants coming into the final weekend of the year, except this is like if we were at the All-Star break.
And I Something believe you like were that. Rooting for the Giants. I was kind of didn't matter, but I'll go with the Braves, and by the end of the season, it'll be just like it finished up yesterday.
Okay, let's take a look at our games of the week. We've got Eisenhower against Altus, and it'd be nice to say that Altus could pull off a major upset, and they did play Vernon tough. Yep. They played just about everybody they played right down to the wire. They played Broken Arrow, one of the better teams, but I still got to go with the Eagles.
I tell you, they played well against Westmore, really well, probably the best they've played all season, but I'm not going to pick them either.
Saturday game will be Burke Burnett taking on Old High. Burke won to break a 3-game losing streak, but the Coyotes, after starting off 0-2, won 3 in a row. Yeah, they're looking pretty good.
And they're looking very good. I'm going to go with the Old High Coyotes as well.
Holiday coming off that crushing loss to top-ranked Boyd taking on Archer City, and Archer City playing at home. I'm going to go with the dreaded week after a major loss, Deflation. And Holiday comes in a little flat, and the Eagles lose it, and Archer City comes away with the win.
I'll tell you, I'm going to go with Holiday. Boyd had a great offense, and Holiday slowed him down a little bit. Archer City, of course, ground up 600 yards last week, so it'll be tough, but I think they'll wear their defense down and pull out a victory.
We'll see if the Cats can pull off what would be one of the shockers of the year. Also, we've got Marlow taking on Frederick, and boy, that is going to be a heck of a game there. Frederick at Marlow, and so I'm going to go ahead and take the home team in that one and
I'll
see if they can
pull it off.
That'll be a great one. It's going on in the last quarter. Now let's go ahead and check out Monday night football action. Washington taking on Miami. Phew, Washington, stinky on the pass defense.
Right. I tell you, my Cowboys are back. They're back. And I expect the Redskins to lose again.
Oh, man. Here he's back on the Cowboy bandwagon. He wouldn't buy him for a dime whenever they didn't have Emmitt Smith. And now all of a sudden, Eddie Murray comes along, kicks 5 field goals against the Packers, and they're going back to the Super Bowl.
Well, I didn't say that.
You said it earlier today. I'll tell everybody else.
Sure.
All right. Thanks for joining us on Gridiron 7. We'll see you next Monday night at 7 for Mike and Brad. This is David, and I'll see you next week.
Gridiron 7 has been a presentation of KSWO-TV. Join us next Monday night at 7 for another edition of Gridiron 7.